Hi, everybody. Welcome to Room and Board. My name is Chris George, and we are taking a look today at 20 more horrible mechanics in board games. They're just the worst. They're awful. They're the worst of the worst, except they're not the worst of the worst. The worst of the worst were in the previous video, which if you didn't see that, go check it out. And this isn't actually like a negative video series. This is a video series all about board game mechanics. And defining board game mechanics, because there are a lot of board game mechanics out there. And so what I thought would be a fun idea for a series, and I did the first one of these about a month ago, and I'm getting back to it now. We'll try to keep on moving along until we reach the best board game mechanics of all time, which are definitively the best and not my opinion, as is pretty much everything on this channel. So if you missed the first video, I would recommend going and checking that out. And in this series, we're going to be defining every single board game mechanic that is listed on Board Game Geek. Almost every single one. We've missed a couple, and those are the ones that I just had really never heard of before. There are a total of 188, I believe, and we're covering 150 of them. Or really, like, 157, because I went off on a tangent, and some are grouped together. Go watch the first one in the series. I do the whole introduction. I'm not going to waste your time with introducing it again, but I wanted to do this not just as defining the board game mechanics, because I think that is useful, and it's interesting to identify what everything is and how we create board games and we mash things together. There are so many times where some idiot YouTuber, I think I said this in the first one, will just rattle off a bunch of mechanics and you go, well, yeah, that would be great if I knew what any of those things were. So this hopefully should exist as a practical video to watch to learn a little bit more about board game mechanics when people reference them, but also I thought it would be more fun to rank all of them. And so I did. I put them all into PubMeeple and I spent hours going through and making all these comparisons. And I'm really happy that I did do that because it made me break down what I really like about a game and what I don't like about a game. And it's kind of cool to think about it in those terms because if you know that about yourself and you know that you really love these mechanics and then later on, something comes out with singing, acting, and measurement movement, and you're like, man, those are my three favorite mechanics. You'll know that you will love that game. And so I think by delving a little bit deeper into mechanics, we can then become better consumers and have more of a chance of liking a game that we haven't tried, that we've potentially got on Kickstarter, that we've just seen on the shelf, that we've heard reviews about. If we know the core principles of the game and we know that we like those core principles, I think that's a valuable tool to have. So let's get into this portion of the list. Today we're ranking 120 to 101. And so these are mechanics that I like board games, right? I like anything to an extent, but these are things that haven't made the top 100. So nobody else is going to make a list about them. These are ones that, well, aren't that fun, or I'm not drawn into that particular point in a game that provides this. There's actually a few on here which I look at and I think, oh, that's this game, and I like that game. But that's not the part about that game that I like. And I think that's also interesting to consider. And so you can have mechanics in games that you aren't necessarily a fan of, and some are just very simple things, which honestly, it's hard to have a bit of an opinion about, but they fall somewhere in this list. But I still think all are worth talking about. So let's do that right now. And spoiler alert for the last episode, all of these are better than hand management, because clearly when I was making the last list, I didn't realize that I actually enjoy hand management. I must have thought it was something else, and I put it at 127, and now I have to stand by that for the rest of my life. So if you ever hear me say that I enjoy hand management, well, just know that I'm a liar, and my opinion cannot be trusted moving forward. But let's get into it. Number 120 is the mechanic command cards. And speaking of hand management, well, with command cards, players generally have a set number of cards in their hand, and playing a card allows them to activate a unit or a space on the board. And I don't actually know if I've played many games that include this. Memoir 44 is a big one that includes this, at least that's what Board Game Geek is saying. Mythic Battles Pantheon also has these because you have your actual cards. And then a lot of war games have these, naturally, by the term command cards. Commands and Colors, that's one of them that has it as well. The reason why I think this one is a lot lower on the list than others is because I like having the freedom of being able to choose what I activate when. This is part of what didn't compel me too much about Dune Imperium, is that I wanted to put my person where I wanted to put them. I didn't want to be hamstrung by my cards at that moment in time. I just wanted to do my strategy. And so I can see where if you like having those constraints and having to work within those constraints, that might be really appealing to you. For me, I think I like other sorts of player activations a little bit better. So it's something with command cards isn't going to jump out at me, but again, it's not going to make me like hate the game like those other 30 would. Hand management. I'm looking at you. Except I'm not. So next mechanic on our list is number 119, and that is map addition. This is also kind of a weird one to rank. Basically, map addition is you're exploring something, and as you explore, the map grows and grows out from under you. So things like Seventh Continent is a prime example of this. You are exploring the island and discovering more of it as it happens. Mansions of Madness has this. Clank Legacy has this, and I do like the expanding map. Magic Maze, I guess, has this, and I really like it in Magic Maze. I like that sense of exploration that map addition brings you. I actually think this might be a little low, but I have to trust past Chris and believe that all the other ones above it are higher, or should be higher. But the fun part about this map addition is that you don't know what's going to happen, and I guess that could also be the frustrating part. If you don't like that lack of predictability, or you don't like that sense of exploration. I say that as if it's a bad thing. Yeah, if you don't like having fun, you know, if you don't like uncovering the sense of mystery, well, maybe map addition shouldn't be your number one, like it isn't for mine. But I think the reason why it is so far down on the list is because related to just how you build the board and not necessarily what's going on in the game. Although I suppose a lot of these mechanics could be said in a similar way. It's a piece of the puzzle and it's not the whole puzzle. I do like the idea of revealing things as you go. I think that is a fun aspect of gaming. Now, I think also where it fell is because map addition is very different than tile placement. So map addition is actually specifically related to exploring a map or creating a terrain, whereas tile placement is a much different thing of having something in your hand and then affecting the board and being able to interact with the board. And I think those two distinctions are important and likely why map addition fell down below, because I always thought, well, it's no tile placement, right? So that's probably why it ended up down here, but that's map addition. Now, number 118, that's what we're on. I forget immediately as I say the other ones. In number 118 is physical removal. And this isn't just, you know, capturing a piece and taking it off the board. That's something different, which I'm sure I've covered. That one's literally called static capture. You're taking something. But physical removal is dexterity. It's a dexterity game. It's Jenga. You have to physically remove a piece, and that's part of the game. It's bamboleo, or I like to call it bambolio. It's kerplunk. It's any of these physical, dexterous games, and there's something to be said about enjoying that experience. It can be nerve-wracking about physically removing a piece, and I suppose you can tie in physically adding a piece on, although maybe you can't. You can't, because that's coming soon. But there's something satisfying about it, right? Like, I don't own a copy of Jenga. I don't think I would pull out a copy of Jenga very frequently. And yet if there's a stack of Jenga, well, yeah, I'm gonna wanna go over and try to push a piece out. I'm human. I have a heart and bleed just like anybody else. It's an enjoyable aspect to a game, but it's also not something that's gonna get me revved up about it, right? That's why it's also down at the bottom of this list. But if you like those sorts of physical things, well then now you know the actual term that's used on Board Game Geek, and that is physical removal. On to number 117. And number 117, this is one of those where I immediately think of a game and think, I don't like that aspect of that game, but I see the potential for it, and that's Tug of War. And the game I'm thinking about is Seven Wonders Duel. In the military track, you move the piece over, and then I play military, and I move it back, and then I move it a bit more, and then I move it a bit more, and then you play some cards, and you move it back. And it is this literal tug of war with a rope, as if one of you is Bowser, and the other of you or the other three Mario Party characters, and you're all just, I don't know what that's gonna look like on camera, you're all just, you know, if you know, you know. Come on. Blisters right there. But you are engaged in this tug of war to see who can really just muscle past your opponent. And I think the reason why I don't like this, and I think this should actually be lower, honestly, now future Chris would love to ameliorate this list, but unfortunately we can't. Those are the rules. But I think why I dislike this as a mechanic is because it feels very inelegant, you know? It just feels like brute strength. It feels like me in an escape room just trying to brute force everything instead of actually considering the solution. Yes, I will pick up the table maze and shake it upside down instead of actually going through the way you wanted me to do the puzzle. And this is interesting. The number one game is almost Seven Wonders Duel on Board Game Geek that they reference, but it's actually Twilight Struggle. Twilight Struggle apparently has this mechanism. I haven't played Twilight Struggle yet. I would like to. But you have this central neutral piece that you are trying to push back and forth. And even just thinking about it, it kind of makes me, you know what it does? It makes me stressed. That's what it does. It makes me stressed that I won't be able to push it back in time. Maybe that is the Mario Party trauma of falling off a cliff, Squid Game style. Waluigi did it first. But yeah, it just feels like an inelegant way of doing things, and yet a very effective way of doing it as well. In one there where your position is directly proportional to how well the other player is doing as well. It doesn't matter how many points you get. You're not accruing points. You just need to get it to the other side and you win. Now, number 116 is the action cue. And this is what happens in a lot of programming games. Players will create a sequence of actions and then execute them in order. And so this is actually a really wide term. There's a lot of games that use some variation of this without it being very specific. But I think what really jumps to mind first for me is the programming aspect. Something like Robo Rally, where you put all of your cards down, or Colt Express, where you're putting them all down, usually face down, and then you flip them over and you see if your person ends up in the right space where you want them to end up. That's what's called a batched action queue, because they all happen at once. They all happen in a batch. You put the actions in and then you resolve them. There's also something known as a rolling action queue, where you start with an action and then you'd play a card on top of that and do that action. And then you'd play another card and you do 1, 2, 3. And so you keep rolling the actions along, but they follow that similar sequence. So something like Root, for example, with the birds, the Eerie, I think that's what they're called, they have that rolling action queue because you are constantly adding to it and getting to do more and more actions. And the moment you can't, then it all falls apart and you have to start again. So there's the two very different, I think very different in feeling of a style of action queue, but it's the same mechanic. It's both filed under the mechanic of action queue, and I really think it should be different. It's different enough in feeling that it should be separated. And if it were separated, rolling action queue would absolutely be way up at the top. Well, not way up at the top, but significantly higher than this is right now. As it stands, the action queue reminds me too much of just straight programming and not that rolling element. Marvel United is another example of a mini rolling action queue, right? Because you get to always use the action of the previous person's actions beforehand. It's kind of cool. It's cool when you see how all these things mesh together. And you're thinking, oh yeah, that does borrow from here, and that does borrow from here. It's even saying that Gloomhaven has an example of an action queue. And I suppose it does, because you all choose what actions you're going to do, and then you reveal it, and you execute them in order of initiative. And you can't really talk about the initiative. Well, you can, but you can't say it specifically, right? So there's all these different applications, which is really neat how one central mechanic can be applied in all these various ways. But eventually, or inevitably for me, it is the programming one that I think of the most for action queue, and I'm sure that's what brought it down, because I like programming games. I think they're fun, I think they're fine, but they're not anything I'm going to want to continuously play all the time, which is weird because I don't have that issue with hidden movement, and that's almost in the same vein. But for me, it's funny and fun when your action goes off the rails and, okay, I didn't predict that's what you were going to do, and then I'm gone. it just doesn't pull me in as much. Although, one of the games that I'm excited on that I did back on Kickstarter, Dragon Bond Lords of Vala, also has this action cue element. And that's one of the main parts of the game, and I think that's one of the parts that really drew me in. That you do have to anticipate the movement, but in an area control sense, that feels a bit better than that sort of square grid movement that I associate with something like Robo Rally, right? If you've heard of any of these games or you've played any of these games, I throw them out as reference points not to say, go out and try them, it's the only way you'll be able to understand. But just as, you know, quick references if you have played them, or when you do play them, maybe you'll look out for it and say, ah, yes, I know this. That's an action cue. Now, board game mechanic number 115 is the advantage token. And this is, as it sounds, there is a token that provides one player an advantage. And usually it's a one-time use token, and you've earned this token and you can use the advantage. So for Ankh, for example, has an advantage token. If you are the one to trigger the battle, you get this advantage token, and then once per battle phase, you can break a tie in your favor. Or against your favor if you want, I think. You can choose who wins, but you're always going to want to win because you get points in that instance. And this is usually used as something to either incentivize getting to a certain spot first or triggering a battle, to give a bonus for taking the action that does that thing, so that there's always an incentive to go forward, or something to work as a balance mechanic. And it could be something as simple as, oh, you're second player and I'm first player, well then you get an advantage token that you can use to break a tie throughout the game. It can be pretty simple like that to create a sense of balance that one player can use at the perfect time to turn the tide in their favor. And it's down here in the bottom, not making the top 100 because, well, I've never seen a game and I've gone, oh man, that's got an advantage token? Sign me up, please. Right? Like, it's just a thing that you put in a game and sure, but it's not gonna ever make somebody wanna go out and purchase that game. I assume, let me know if I'm wrong, if you are on the hunt for advantage tokens, let me know how your search has happened, how you developed this fervor and this passion for advantages. And if it was through watching Survivor, I understand, because I also want all of those advantages when I get on the show. Actually, I want zero because I want to earn it, you know, on my own merit. That's besides the point. That's number 115, the advantage token. Now, number 114 is grid coverage. And this also is how it sounds. You have a grid and you try to cover it with various pieces. This is also referred to as the Tetris effect and usually refers to games with polyominoes. You have these shapes and you are attempting to cover a grid. A great example of this is Patchwork, where the whole game is basically grid coverage. You are trying to cover your grid as effectively as possible. Patchwork, for those of you who don't know, is a game about building a little quilt. And so you're gonna be taking a polyomino, a Tetris-shaped piece, and putting it onto your board and trying to cover your board better than the other person. But what's also interesting about how they define it on Board Game Geek, and I think it's right to define it this way and meld these together, it's just defined as anything where you're covering stuff with stuff. Really. So Castles of Burgundy is actually the highest rated game in the grid coverage mechanism family because everybody has their own individual board and you are trying to cover it. And covering it is a important part of the game because you get bonuses for covering yours sooner. If you cover it in the first round, you're going to get more points than if you covered it in the last round, if you finished covering that section. And so I do like grid coverage. There's something satisfying about starting with nothing and ending up with something and seeing the progression that you've made. And in a sense, this is why a lot of people really enjoyed the mini expansion for Castles of Burgundy, the new deluxe edition, that I knew there was gonna be a mini expansion because you give one mini, well, you gotta give minis for all of the pieces, right? Of course you do. I've seen Terraforming Mars deluxe editions. Although that's interesting to me that Terraforming Mars isn't considered grid coverage on Board Game Geek currently. And I suppose it's the publishers or designers who put this sort of thing on there or as this classification. But I think because it is specifically related to your own specific portion of the board. Terraforming Mars, that's a different board. That's a main board that everybody has that they can cover. Castles of Burgundy, Patchwork, these are both your own board that you are covering specifically. So that might be where the distinction lies. Either way, that's grid coverage. Again, down here, below sub 100, because, well, I guess it doesn't make me excited. I can get excited about it, but I don't think it makes me excited. And also, I'm not as huge on patchwork as a lot of people are. A lot of people love patchwork. I've tried it out a bunch as a gateway game to try to get people interested in gaming, and it's never been met with the enthusiasm that I've wanted it to be met with. And so I think I've soured a little bit on patchwork because of that, and also maybe because I'm horrible at it, but that usually doesn't stop me. So I think that's potentially why grid coverage takes a hit, because I associate it a lot with patchwork, but there's many games that incorporate it as well. Moving along to 113, we have Rock, Paper, Scissors. And this is only games that feature rock, paper, scissors, such as, I don't know if you've heard of it, Paper, Scissor, Rock. Did anybody else grow up calling it Paper, Scissors, Rock? I thought for the longest time everybody else was wrong. I mean, you can call it whatever you want. There's three items and that's what it is. It has taken me a long time to grow accustomed to saying rock, paper, scissors. But in this one, you'll see it in a lot of games. You'll see it in a lot of games that there are a set three things or four things, or we can't really have two things. There'll be a set of three things where this thing is better against that thing. That thing is better against this thing. This thing's better against this thing. I feel like Coup is almost a really good example of this, because you have the Contessa, which blocks the assassin, and you have the Duke, which steals, which gets coins, and the Captain, which steals coins, but the Ambassador, which blocks the stealing. It's a little bit more complicated, and you don't have that direct circle, which I think is integral to the rock, paper, scissors mechanic, where it is all about outguessing your opponent. And this is such a simple mechanic that is probably lower on a lot of people's lists, but I think for me, I really love games that have mind games in them and where you have to read what your opponent is doing. And that is this mechanic. That is the whole proponent of this mechanic. That is the reason this mechanic exists. You have to look into your opponent's eyes and say, I know you're doing this thing. Here's a tip. If we ever rock, paper, scissors, I always pick rock. And I always pick rock because of that reference from The Simpsons where Lisa and Bart play rock, paper, scissors. Poor Bart. He always chooses rock. Good old rock. Nothing beats that. He puts it out and Lisa wins. And I just think that reference is so funny. And I always make myself laugh by doing that, that it often is more important to me to make myself laugh by putting the little rock out than actually worry about winning the game. So there's your tip. If we ever have to rock, paper, scissors for something, now you know how to beat me. Or now you know how to keep an endless stream of ties going, which is the funnier option. Anyway, that's why the mechanic's higher up for me, but it, you know, it's still just rock, paper, scissors. It's still a little bit basic. It's not that ingenuitive or elegant, but a little bit more elegant than Tug of War, just back and forth. So that's why it's here at number 113. Just above it, at number 112, we have team-based games. And that is, again, how it sounds. Games that are specifically designed for a team versus a team. While 1v1 might not necessarily fall into this category because you can play a lot of things 1v1 that's just called a two-player game, but 2 versus 2, 3 versus 3, 2 versus 2 versus 2 is a team game, 1 versus all is also a team game. Anything that falls into those categories can fall into a team game. And I think it's the 1 versus all that kind of sends it up. And I also think that I want to like team games. I do like team games. I grew up playing Bridge. You're a team in that. It's nice to have a partner. A lot of card games are team games in essence because you have a partner. And it is nice to have a partner to rejoice in a shared victory and not feel like it's everybody against you all at one time. Well, unless of course it's 1v1, but then that's the point of the game, right? Your powers are superpowered compared to everybody else's. But I also think, if I'm really honest with myself, this is my least favorite player count. I like games where you can work together with people, but you're not forced to work together with people. Because I often find with team games, it can lend itself to one member of the team being a lot more active than the other member. And if you get that imbalance, it's not going to be a great experience. Team games could be lower. Team games could be higher. Like, I've had some good experiences. I've had some not so good experiences. That's why it landed where it did at number 112. Next up at number 111, counter to physical removal, we have stacking and balancing. And this is the opposite of physical removal. Physical removal, you take things out, you take things away. Stacking and balancing, well, you stack and you balance. You hope that they don't all fall. This is Meeple Circus. This is junk art. This is, you know, any game with wooden pieces while you're waiting for your turn to happen. And listen, stacking and balancing is the core mechanic of Meeple Circus, and I think Meeple Circus is a great game. It really is. It's been such a hit with everybody else out there, but it lends itself to being in the party game genre. I don't think you're going to get a seriously strategic game that incorporates stacking and balancing because it's dexterity, right? Dexterity often means light, fun, quicker, unless you're playing Catacombs. But stacking and balancing, it's never going to be a deep thinky game. It's about if your pieces fall over or if you go for the glory. In my only Instagram post on the Room and Board Instagram. That is a red meeple that has gotten to level 6. And I'll be honest, it is level 6. It's not level 7. I would have needed another elephant under that for it to be level 7. There's something immensely satisfying about it, but there's also something for me where I can grow tired of it a little bit. It's not something that I want to do over and over, but it's something that I would do for a little while for sure. This is actually, and I think the reason why it is sort of lower, sub 100 again, for me personally, this is what stopped me from backing Awakened Realms' Knockdown. They had Awakened Realms Lite put out this, you know, fighty battler game where you have to stack all these pieces up. And I don't know, it was an element to stacking all the pieces up in a quick amount of time. And if you did that, I think this is what it was. I think if you did that in a certain amount of time, your opponent didn't knock you out. That was the way to save it because you've taken all these stacks of damages. And so you have to stack those damage towers up. And if you don't do it in time, then you lose. And I like that. I like that as a mechanic, but even talking about that makes it sound fun. But at the same time, I fear that sort of thing grows stale for me personally. So that's why it is down here where it is. Number 111, stacking and balancing. Moving along to number 110, we have movement points. And likely you've heard of movement points. This shouldn't be an obscure reference, or maybe it is. Basically, you have a character, and if you take the move action, well, you can move the number of spaces according to your movement points. That's it. And this is specifically not action points. I think that is important to be clear about. It is specific to the movement points, and according to Board Game Geek, it is often related to war games because there are specific terrain that will take more movement points to move through, right? A mountain will be harder to climb than a molehill, of course. And again, movement points is one of those standard things that feels a little bit hard to rank. It's a lot in this section feels nebulous, and I think that's why they all ended up in this area, because I didn't really have an opinion one way or the other on them. I thought they're just a mechanic. They're not something that makes me particularly excited. It's the things around the movement points. I've never been particularly drawn in by the movement point aspect of things, and I often find with a game that has multiple bits of terrain, keeping track of those things either is tedious or feels a bit fiddly or is unintuitive and you just forget about it. And then like halfway through the game, you remember, oh shoot, weren't we supposed to be, you know, taking 2 movement to move through that mountain or to move up the track or wherever the arrow was pointing? And having stuff like that, while I think it makes for a more dynamic board in a smaller space, which is a pro, I think the cons for me, or focusing on it in that way, the cons for me kind of outweigh the pros. But that's a breakdown of movement points to consider how much your character can move, and also to consider the terrain surrounding it, and that it is different from action points, because often using your action point, you can move or do something else, right? It's kind of a subset, but falls into a similar category. So yeah, let me know if you can think of a game that really revolutionizes how you use movement points. I think that's interesting. Now, mechanic number 109 is the catch the leader mechanic. And this is, as it sounds, it is a literal catch-up mechanic that is baked into the game. The leader might get one resource, and then the second place person might get 2 resources, and then the third and fourth place people, they might get 3 resources. Because they are further in behind, you get more resources. Actually, Seafall uses this as part of their setup in their legacy setting, because the first player or the person who's in the lead has likely won more games and they've gotten more opportunities to level up permanently their board. Then whoever's in behind, they get additional stats and gold and points that they can basically use on various things and various bonuses to account for that difference, so that it is a competitive game and that there isn't just a runaway leader. And I think this is really important in games that can have a runaway leader to balance it and make everything feel competitive and make everything feel accessible. Because if the leader is getting too much stuff and that's why they're in the lead, because they've gotten all this good stuff and there's no way to take that good stuff away from them, then they're just continually going to snowball and move further and further ahead. And that makes for a bad game. It makes for a not fun experience for honestly everybody playing, because the leader's like, well, this is too easy. And then everybody else is like, well, there's no catching them now. Why bother even finishing? So I think having a catch the leader mechanic is very important in some games. And in some games, it's not necessary at all. The other side of things could be looked at it that, well, you should just get good. That's it, right? And I understand that feeling as well. So I recognize the importance of having a catch-up mechanic or a catch-the-leader mechanic, but it's also not going to be something that's going to convince me to purchase a game. In fact, it might actually do the opposite, because I will all usually tend to skew away from those sorts of things. If I know that they're like, hey, don't worry, this one has a catch-the-leader mechanic, I'll say, well, too bad, just get good. And walk the other way. Now, this is distinguished on Board Game Geek from establishing turn order, because there is a turn order, which is turn order stat based. It is whoever's in the lead basically won't get the beneficial turn order spot. So if it's specific to turn order, then that's what it is. But if it is taking place anywhere else outside the game, then catch the leader makes sense. So Power Grid actually has both of these. You have the turn order determined by the stats on the board and how everybody's doing. And you also still have a catch the leader mechanic in how you purchase the resources. Although saying it now, it's kind of all related to turn order, but there's just a different variation of turn order as you go along. So I think that might actually be mislabeled, honestly, because for me, I can't really think of a catch the leader mechanic that happens in Power Grid that isn't associated with turn order. So there you go. Suburbia is another one where the further the leader gets ahead, the more red lines they will cross, which means the more their population and their economic growth will go down. Anyway, that's it for catching the leader. It's clearly better than, you know, 41 things and worse than 108. I don't know why I'm singing its praises so much. I do know why, and it's because of Ankh. Now that, certainly won't find a catch the leader mechanic on that one. Moving on to the only thing that can be just better than catch the leader and still worse than everything else, and that is the mechanic of pieces as map. That's what it's referred to on Board Game Geek, and it's literally when you use your player pieces also to create the board or the playing area. The best example of this is Hive, where you, on your turn, you can add a piece to the grid, to the Hive, and then that piece allows additional pieces to be played off of it. That's what it means in terms of pieces as a board, because you can move these pieces, but they're also the surface on which you play. Although the Night Cage is also referenced on this, and having just played that once so far, I can see that, but there is a board and you are placing your pieces down on it, but it's creating the board. I don't know, I think that's a bit of a stretch, honestly. It feels like a stretch, but the distinction between tile placement, after having just, you know, looked this up, the distinction between tile placement and pieces as a board is that if it remains active, and most importantly, if it continues to have its own agency after the placement has finished. It's hard to create these sorts of distinctions, but I think it's important to recognize that there are these distinctions and what implications they can have on the game. And in some, you know, it's just going to be like, it's the same thing, whatever. But in others, it will make a difference. So for the Night Cage, for example, you put down a monster, and that monster will react to other things that are happening on the board. It has been placed down, but it still has its own agency. Whereas in Carcassonne, you place your person down, you put a person on it, and then it doesn't do anything else. Sure, you can build off of it and you can block things, but that specific tile doesn't actually do anything else. It just becomes a part of the map that you've created. I think that's the distinction there, if you're going for the difference between why the Night Cage is listed like this and Carcassonne is not. For me, the better example is Hive, because you are constantly shifting these pieces around and creating new openings for things to occur, which I think is fun. So that's pieces as map, number 108. Now next up, we have a mechanic that I see in so many games, and if it's in a game, I will never, ever use it. And that is number 107, loans. I hate loans in games. I recognize their importance. I still hate them. I don't hate them. I do hate them. I said it, so I must hate them. I recognize that loans can be an integral part to certain strategies that you need to push yourself forward, and then of course take a negative point value because of this. You are accelerating your own plans in order to hopefully make up those points or negate the penalty that you accrue because you decided to accelerate your plans. And then the calculation becomes, okay, do I accelerate the plans? Is it worth that cost, or can I achieve it later on and not make up that calculation? And I like math. I like math a lot. I find loans to be just so annoying. Maybe it's too close to real life. No, I'm debt-free, thank you very much. I may be poor, but I'm debt-free. I understand, I think I recognize that this is a key strategic decision that should be made. When do you take a loan? When do you not? Can you avoid taking the loan that the other person took, and will that be the difference in your scores? I see the potential, and I just don't like it. And I'm not sure why I don't like it, because it is an interesting strategic decision. I think I don't like it because I am never going to take it because I am fairly risk adverse, just in my day-to-day. Maybe you've seen that from the channel of me trying to talk myself out of doing things, right? It's that risk aversion that I don't want to take the negative points. And so it's never a path that I end up going down. And I usually am still able to pull out the win anyway. So I've never seen an example where the loan strategy has worked. And perhaps if I saw a game where taking loans was an integral part of the strategy, or to seeing somebody's glorious winning because they were able to take these loans, then I might be turned around. But likely if that's happening, somebody's taking a whole bunch of loans, well then I can take a few loans and close that gap, and it makes it more of almost a tug of war situation than a loan situation, because we're just, well, that's not true. I'm just closing the gap. It's more relative movement at that point to pull out number 145. All right, let's keep moving this along. I feel like I'm getting a lot more long-winded because I knew I was only doing 20 instead of 30 this time and felt like I could take my time. And I like talking about this. I hope you are enjoying this breakdown of the various mechanics and the various applications of said mechanics. And hopefully that's giving you a more complete picture of the possibility for all of these different mechanics, or at least maybe it'll stick in your brain a little bit more. I hope it sticks in my brain a little bit more too. I know there've been a few of these where I've had to reference, but remembering my previous video, I go, oh yeah, now I know the applications for that, and it makes a little bit more sense to me. And I'm excited about that because I feel like it makes me a smarter board gamer, a smarter consumer, and potentially a better resource on YouTube as well. So a win-win for me. Unlike one person in number 106, and that is the single loser game mechanic. This is very simple, again, as it sounds. One person loses, everybody else wins. The number one game that jumps to my head about this is Cockroach Poker. Cockroach Poker is you just don't want to lose. I guess a lot of stacking and balancing games have this as well. Jenga. One person loses, everybody else wins, because that one person was the person to knock over the stack. And I don't mind single loser games. Honestly, I think this is up higher because I enjoy Cockroach Poker and I think it's a lot of fun. But I also recognize that in a single loser game, there's going to be one person who starts to lose early on and then is just dogpiled upon for the rest of the game. And depending on your group, and depending upon that person, this can make for a very disappointing experience or a not great feeling if they don't take it well, of everybody picking on them, right? This can sour an evening fairly quickly if you have people who take this sort of thing too seriously. I don't like that. I don't like that the possibility of that is going to happen. I do like cockroach poker, and I think it is fun to, you know, pile upon that one person and just try to get it off of you as quickly as possible. But I don't like that sense of piling on or having somebody potentially piled upon. And this, it feels different in a game where somebody is a clear winner and everybody's working together to pull them back down so that everybody else has a chance to win. That's, I think, fine because everyone is pursuing their own goals and it's not just about, well, let's, you know, make sure Chris doesn't win. Although many games often that I play turn out that way. because I'm incredible at board games. I said it. No, they often turn out that way, and I don't mind because it does feel like everyone is still pursuing their own goals. As long as everybody is pursuing their own goals, it feels less personal, and I think that also helps lessen the sting in a single loser game, but, you know, what's more to say? Let's move on. Now, number 105 is the mechanic of bias. And this is an interesting one, because it's not, at least to me, what the name suggests. Bias is a definitive thing that will happen to a player piece. So the main example given, or the number one game, or the highest rated game on the list in this category, is Sulcan. And the reason that being, there are these gears that are constantly, every turn, they're going to move up one. And so you know that your worker will continue to move along these gears. That's the idea of bias, that there are these portions of the board that will make your character do a certain thing. Robo Rally, also in programming, has a similar thing. If you put your robot on the conveyor belt, they'll then move on the conveyor belt every single turn. And so bias is an interesting thing because it's not something that I'm that interested in. But I like how it is used to replicate a lot of different things. Currents, wind, the conveyor belts of Robo Rally. Those are the examples that they actually give in the description. And that, to me, is appealing. That I can see the implications of it. I can see how it can be used. I can see how that's getting me a little bit excited about it. And yet, I don't often rejoice when I see it in a game. Sulcan is one of my favorite because I love how you can get your workers to have better stuff. You can upgrade your workers or give them better abilities the longer they stay on the gears. But I think it's more about the abilities and less that they are always moving. Now our next one is another casualty of war, but this one actually got promoted, and honestly this and action queue should be switched because this is programmed movement. This is the specific part of action queue that I dislike, and yet it has managed to be above action queue because it's easier to understand. I guarantee you past Chris in his tired fugue state was like, yeah, I know what program movement is, and then forgot what action queue was on the, you know, fifth time that he was trying to rank it against something. I'm fairly certain that's what would have happened, but it's definitive. Program movement is right here, and programmed movement is you set up what your people are going to do, you reveal it, and then they do that thing. And they may have hiccups along the way, but they keep on doing their programming, and they keep on trying to make it happen. Likely it will not happen because you screwed up something. I do like the way Robo Rally does this on a timer. This feels like this episode's sponsored by Robo Rally. There is that timer element to it. Yeah, Colt Express is another one that uses this. There's, a whole list of things that you can look up just based on program movement. But I guarantee you, program movement is not the thing that will ever get me to purchase a game. I know it is for some people, but for me, it just isn't. I like it, but it feels more like a gimmick than something I actually want to invest consistent time into. However, fittingly, right above program movement at number 103 is pattern movement. I like pattern movement more. Yes, this is chess. This is chess in a nutshell. Each piece can move in a different pattern. And I'm quite fond of chess. I grew up playing chess. I still play chess with my good friend every now and then. I try to get him to play all my board games on the shelf, and all he requests is chess. And I say, fine. And then we always have a good time when we do it. In terms of modern board gaming, Onitama is a great example of this. And this game, The Duke, is an example of this, which I have not played, but I found for a friend of mine. He was looking for it forever and couldn't find it. And then I found a copy for him and told him where to get it. He was very happy. So that's my experience for the Duke. And I think the possibilities of pattern movement, that they date back for so long, you gotta give it its place in the sun. And that place is, of course, just shy of the top 100 best board game mechanics of all time. We're getting into the best. We're almost out of the worst. I assume 100 is the threshold where I can stop saying horrible mechanics and move on to these are the best ones until we cover more better ones. The penultimate mechanic of this list, number 102, is flicking. Flicking is a mechanic. Flicking is Crokinole. Flicking is Catacombs. Flicking is Terror in Meeple City. Flicking is having a little disc and flicking it across the table and trying to get it in the spot that you want. Flicking is way better than both physical removal and stacking and balancing. I 100% got this right. Flicking is fun. Flicking is curling. Flicking is shuffleboard. Flicking is life. Okay, that's enough about flicking. But what's interesting is the definition of this. It says a physical action is required to determine the outcome of an action. So it is a specific element to the board, but you have to do something to see if that thing happens. And that's kind of a cool way of framing it. And phrasing it in that way also opens the door for a lot more strategic components or strategic tie-ins than, you know, perhaps the way everything else has been framed. Maybe not. I mean, stacking, you gotta stack things to see if you did your action. Flicking feels a little bit more exciting and precise. You don't know where that disc is gonna go after it leaves your fingers, but you hope it goes where you want it to go. So flicking is number 102. And then finally, number 101, the last one of this episode, the last one just outside the top 100 mechanics, and that is role-playing. I know, it just barely missed it, but hey, it's significantly better than acting and singing. I'll tell you that for free. But I think the reason why role-playing just missed it is that it's dependent on energy. It's dependent on your personal energy, and it is dependent upon the vibe of the room and the group that you're with. I love role-play. I mean, just ask Maggie. She'll tell you. Well, just delete that last part. Just ask Furry Scott Bakula. He'll, no. Okay. We can't use that twice in a week. Now, Board Game Geek defines marriage as, enough of that. Board Game Geek is defining role-playing as perhaps a proponent of storytelling, which is, I think, what we all associate it with. But it can also be a proponent of even variable player powers or just representing that a character will grow over time, that a character will change over time, is an element of role-playing. I think that's a core element to anything that's defined as an RPG, a video game, or a game, is that you have a character and they get better over time. And that aspect of role-playing, I think, is really fun. But it's the storytelling aspect of role-playing I think sometimes people try to jam into their games, and they can be great, and I love doing it when I want to do it. It's like acting and singing. It's like, when I want to do that thing, I'm gonna have an awesome time doing it. If I'm playing a game that has that thing, it can actively be a bar or a barrier to entry because I'm not feeling up to it that night, right? I think a lot of introverts can probably agree. You need to have that motivation and reason for doing that thing. And so I think that's why role-playing ended up getting pushed down, because I recognize its strengths, and it can be huge strengths, and it can be a lot of fun, and I also recognize its weaknesses. And I also recognize that role-playing campaigns take a heck of a long time to do, and I don't have time for them anymore, I'm so sorry, because I'm too busy trying to cram in as many board games as humanly possible so that I have important things to say and tell and advise you all on this channel. So, unfortunately, role-playing, you are a casualty of that, but I do think the idea of getting a character better over time is awesome. It's so awesome, and it's a blast. But it's the other elements and the potential barrier to entry, like we talked about, that make it number 101. Anyway, that's it. We're just doing 20 this time. That's it for the list. Let me know, out of these, what mechanics you think should have been here, should have been lower, should have been higher. I'm curious. Are there any here that shocked you that they are a specific mechanic or a listed mechanic on Board Game Geek? I think what's been really interesting and exciting to me about doing these lists is realizing that that little element to a game actually is in so many different games, and I just never realized it until I started looking at things through this lens. Seeing the web of how things interlink and move throughout the different board games is really cool to me. And it's also cool to consider the ways we can mash things together and the combinations of mashing things together, and if that will create an interesting experience or a flop as well. I think those things are sort of cool. I think this section, there were a lot of pretty self-explanatory, pretty standard mechanics, or pretty easy to understand mechanics, but yeah, let me know if anything was surprising, and I'm always interested. Anyway, that's it. We're gonna be finished now. Goodbye. Thank you so much for watching. I'm Chris George, and I don't have a catchphrase. But I will try and do one of these, continue the series sooner than later. See you in the next one.